this is a special testimony. I've never heard a testimonial that quite measure up to what you're going to hear now. This is worth more than me preaching 30 or 45 minutes. But I'm going to call on Brother Al Jackson. This is a miracle, miracle, miracle. And we know how long his struggle has been, what he's gone through. And when he went through the marriage class, when God began to work, and Brother Al said, my marriage went from this to way up. But God wasn't done. God has blessed him in another area. So he's going to share this. I want you to listen very attentively. And we just want to just rejoice after he gives this testimony.
Amen.
The word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing asunder of the soul, spirit, joint, and marrow. And it's a discerner of the intent of our hearts. I said all that because that's the word of God. That's Hebrews, I believe, 4th chapter, verse 12, I think. But anyhow, I heard a testimony from Sister Denise about a month ago, and she was sharing a testimony about what happened to her at Miss Jackson's, and she also shared about a new job that she had just received. And I got a call from a friend of mine, probably one of my closest friends, Dennis. He was moving back to Tulsa, and he needed an apartment to stay in. And I knew a lady that I used to work with years ago, her name was Kathy Russell. And she and I hadn't talked in some time, it's probably been about 2 years. And so I told Rod, I said, Rod, I'm going to check with her. Because she was in the apartment business. I was her maintenance supervisor for 14 years. And so I gave her a call, and I was on my cell phone, and as I dialed the number, it didn't ring, but I could hear somebody on the other end. And it was her. She was calling me at the same time I was calling her. And I said, hello? And she said, hello? She said, Al? I said, yes. She said, hun, what are you doing? I said, I'm talking to you. The only thing I could have been doing at that time, but. So she said, why are you calling me? I said, well, I got a friend. I said, I hear you back in town. I said, he's looking for an apartment. And I knew you had a new project going on. And she said, yeah. She said, yes. She said, just bring him on down. She said, but I was calling you because I need a maintenance supervisor. I said, well, yeah. I said, I got my own business. And I said, even though, you know, right now, I said, it's winter months, you know, things get kind of slow. And she said, well, I just need somebody part-time, maybe, you know, 25 to 30 hours a week. I said, well, yeah. She said, yeah. She said, I'm not going to tell you what she said she'll pay me, but she said, I put it to you like this, it's over $20 an hour. And so I said, she said, would you be interested? I said, oh, I acted like I acted coming to see her like a Republican. I said, I'll think about it. Knowing in my heart, I'm going where the buck is. And, so she said, hey, how about you bring Rod in, and, you know, we talk. And she said, my boss will be here. She said, I want you to talk to him. And I said, okay. So a couple of hours later, I get a phone call that this man was in London, England, and he had called her. We were on a three-way. And he said, are you interested? I said, well, I said, I'll think about it. I said, first I got to pray and, you know, consult my wife. And I knew my wife, you know, she likes money. Yeah, she's like, any woman, you want your husband out there to bring in a buck so that we can live comfortable and live good, you know. So anyhow, I'm sitting there and I'm just thrilled. And so I called Michael Donaldson because I needed to pray. I'm a praying man. I just believe that when you pray and if you give it to God, God is going to, his reward of those that diligently seek him. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So called Brother Donaldson and he didn't answer. So I said, well, what am I going to do? I was pinching myself and said, this can't be real. You know, this can't be real. So anyhow, time came and I took Rod up there and we talked to her. And after we left, she called me when I got home and she said, my boss won't be here until the 19th, but she said, the guy that's under him needs to speak with you. I want you to come in tomorrow morning. Could you come in? I said, sure. So I go in and meet with him. And as I met with him, me and this guy, we only talked for about 5 minutes. And I had convinced him that I was who I said I was. I was a good maintenance man. I told him, I said, what this place need. And right downtown, some of your older folks may know Bill White Chevrolet. They're turning that into some loft apartments. And it's going to be 8-3 apartments down there. So I talked to him. So I talked to the man. He turned around. He told me, he said, well, he said, what type of salary are we talking about? I said, what type of salary can you pay? And I'm still on that Republican side. I'm trying to figure this thing out. So he said, Kathy said that we can give you this. I said, well, I said, I don't know. I said, I need to think about it. He said, okay. So he said, well, I just want to say this. I want you to start work. He said, can you start tomorrow? I said, well, no, not tomorrow. I've got some other engagements. But I said, how about next Monday? And I wasn't thinking that Monday was Martin Luther King's birthday. And so he said, okay. So the next day, Kat called me. She said, hon, she said, I'm sorry. She said, excuse me. She said, you know, yesterday was Martin. I mean, she said, Monday is Martin Luther King's birthday. She said, I just feel that you need to observe that holiday. She said, can you come in too? I said, yeah, that's fine. So then she said to me, she said, Al, she said, I got to say this to you. She said, years ago when you worked with me, I had worked with her and we had worked out here on 71st and Trent for 14 years. And when she got ready to leave that place, she took me with her to another company. And I was a maintenance supervisor there. And we had hired another guy that was up under me. And he wasn't of the same race as I. And I had him to do something one day. And he told me, he said, I can't take orders from you. You know what they say? And he spat in my face. When he did that, I just became Al Jackson. I was in church. I was in church, but I wasn't saved. Not all the way. And but I got fired from that job. And when I got fired from that job, I knew I had to look for another job. But she said to me, she said, Al, she said, I didn't stand behind you when that happened. I threw you under the bus. And she said, I just feel that this is a way that I can give back to you. And I just feel that that was felt, that that was nothing but God. And so beginning this Tuesday, I'll be the maintenance supervisor of, I can't even think of the name of the place. I think, I think it's called. Thank you. But
full time.
Yeah, they turned it around from part time. They want me to come in full time. So that's a blessing. But a singer. But when all this happened, it was happening, and I couldn't talk to Brother Donaldson. I sat there and I said to myself, I said, thank you, Lord.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah.
A settled issue. I don't think the pastor have to be wondering that. It's enough faith in this house today to settle this issue today. It's enough faith. People are coming. God is using Sister Deborah. She wants a ministry that she can be proud of. We don't have to be trying to rag them and trying to get all we can out of them when they come over here. But we want to settle this issue today. This issue today. Amen. You know, I felt so sorry for the... I shouldn't be feeling sorry for y'all faith, because how many got faith in here? For the second phase of the project, I am Sister Hill. Just a second. But we're going to, come on, I want y'all to say something. Come on, don't say that. Okay, just come on, Sister Denise. Just, Brother Sonny, come on, tell us what moved you to do 1,000? I'll make it. Did you talk to her, or y'all agreed on that, or did you?
The Lord has the money, and when you say you want the money, just go and say you're going to give it, you know, because, hey, he had everything. He gives us everything. So don't be afraid of money. It's nothing but paper. You know what I mean?
But, hey. Return?
Yeah, return. Sure. And like, hey, there's nothing but paper, so let's give it up.
All right. So we've gotten 1,000. Didn't even think twice, huh?
I just thank God, because the person who makes it possible, of course, is number one, my father, but Sonny, he's been retired for 10 years, and we have not won for nothing. Our house is paid for, our cars are paid for. I mean, maybe not new cars, it's an old home. But I mean, you know, you can't be God-given saints of God. Like you all heard Brother Al say when I said it a few Sundays ago, who would have thought that I would have one of the best alterations jobs in the city? Who would have thought it? I mean, I'm just so grateful. And I was going to share this morning, you know, about, you know, it'll be 6 years this year, you guys. And I was going to tell about how God has healed my face. When I looked in that mirror after I had my surgery, and the devil said, you're going to be ugly the rest of your life. I can't help but praise God when I look in the mirror. I may not be beautiful to you, but I am to him. Yeah. And you guys, I couldn't even talk, and here I am singing. So what's the hell about the money? God is so good. He's been so good to us. Sister Dorothy and all of the saints of God, Brianna's brother, and even Josh, he's not here physically, but he is going to be here. God is in the healing business, thanks to God, and he can move on your hearts to give to this ministry. Pastor, someone said earlier, the pastor, I think it was Sister Debbie, if it wasn't for the Lord and putting in Pastor's heart to cause us to pray, you guys, and seek the Lord, you know that we wouldn't be here praying. We wouldn't be at home praying. He has prayer down in his belly, and he wasn't selfish with it. He shared it with each and every one of us and given us a prayer ministry. That way we can go to God for ourselves, and he can bless us. I just had that in my heart.
So God healed her of an aneurysm. It was bad. The doctors didn't give her about 50% chance, but God turned it around.
Sister Holman, I want you to stand. This is another sister. She don't like to talk much, but Brother Holman is the one that let her do all this. All right, but she is a giver. And this lady has done more for this ministry than you'll ever realize. I mean, there's no stinger bones in her body. And even she gets permission from Brother Holman. She gives a certain amount every month, just for pastoral. And it's more than $25 that y'all ask everybody to do. It's more than that each Sunday that she does for pastoral. You'll be surprised of how, if it weren't for her, it would be very difficult for me to be sustained financially. And she has, amen, done this for months after months after months. That's the one reason why God has brought her back. What have you faced? Come on, just give us the reason why God just keep. She went through a stroke, is that right? An aneurysm?
Yes, sir.
I just thank God because in 2009, I had a heart attack. And then I had a stroke in 2010. I was paralyzed from the right side. I couldn't eat, I couldn't talk, I couldn't do anything. But I just thank God where I am today. And whatever I can do to bless someone when the Holy Spirit tells me to do it, I do it. You know, because I get a joy out of that. And when you bless the pastor, you'll be blessed.
Yeah.
And when he laid it on my heart, when pastor would get up here and he would say certain things, and you know, but I faithfully do that, and God has blessed me every week. My bonuses, you know, I look at how people bless me because I bless them with the Holy Spirit. And they can see what I have in me when I come to pray on Monday nights and read and see for everyone. God gives back to me in a different way. So I just thank him where he brought me from a heart attack and a stroke.
She's not the only one that she gives to. She has certain people that she gives to on a weekly and monthly basis. So we just thank God for the spirit of giving, because there are consequences. God loves a what? God loves a cheerful giver. Okay, I want two or three persons, you know, some of you have made pledges. We just want to talk a little faith. Amen. Let's just get faith working and operating in our hearts today, because I believe that God has laid it on your heart to encourage, to promote, to edify, to exhort in the area of giving today. If you are there, if you are a bigger pledge of $1,000, if you're giving $1,000 or $500 or whatever, I think that this is the opportunity for you to give faith. Because I can talk it all day, every Sunday, but it's not like it coming from Sister Denise, Brother Sonny, who has Sister Hope, and it's not like it coming from me. It's a different order altogether. So I want, if you are for what we're doing, if you feel that what we're doing, what we're establishing in this ministry is worthy of support, and you are willing to put your support.
Grandpa, as I come back here several years ago, we did the youth ministry, and then we went back to Rhema. So we feel that to come back. So we come back, and we're back now during the youth ministry. But God has really been blessing us, period. God is an awesome God. I mean, through sickness and just financially, God has really gave us the ability. Well, we had a ministry. Let me back up a little bit. We had a ministry a while ago. We started the ministry. And the foundation of that ministry was a giving. And he would supply the seed for the sower. And basically, that's all we did. We gave so much that a lot of our home church people, one of the pastors at our home church back in Detroit, started calling our house here the Donaldson Hotel. We were bringing so many people in to help them get established and started here. We've had everyone from ministers from Africa to homeless individuals who are living out of a car, off a bike, in the street. And through that, Lord has really, really been blessing us. We got a few minutes. Can I tell you a quick testimony? I'll tell you a few people. My wife, she will speak, but we came here, and it's almost 20 years ago now, this year. Show you how the Lord works when you stay in his will. We've been blessed so much. We used to tease each other who would get the biggest Christmas bonus. You know, that's how much we were being blessed in Detroit, because we were giving then. But we looked at each other, the Lord laid on our hearts. She let go of Ford, I let go of General Motors, and we came here to go to Reno Bible Church. That in itself, how he did it, just, I'll give you that real quick. We sit up in church on Christmas Eve, New Year's Eve. pastor, Bishop Butler, if y'all know, just preaching. We're a little ways back. We're not up front. We're a little ways back. And so the Lord had laid on our hearts about going to Rhema. And we had investigated. We found out that they had a Bible study, and that wasn't it. That just didn't agree with me. So Bishop Butler was just preaching. Oh, he's gone. He's gone. All of a sudden, and we both heard it and saw it. It's like the lights went, and it was just a circle, a light around him. And he came off the stage, pointed at us, and said, if you don't get out of that ankle-deep water and get into water over your head, you're going to drown. And then all of a sudden we heard him, and he was back on the stage preaching. We turned, looked at each other. If that wasn't God, if that wasn't God, I mean, we got to get into water. You would think you're getting on the water over your head, you would drown. No, he said we would drown in that ankle deep water. Meaning that we're operating way beneath where we're supposed to be. Some of you out there are doing the same thing. You think you're operating in the safe zone in that ankle deep water. You got to get into a spot where it's uncomfortable. You got to get in that water that's over your head. And you'll find out that the water beneath you may continue to go down, but that which is over you will never get over your head. Because he will sustain you. It's like Peter. Everybody get on Peter on the negative side. But Peter did get out of that boat. And Peter did walk on that water. Cut it there. Get the rest of it. Don't get on the negative side. Get out of the boat. Walk on the water. Then take it from there. So we got out of the boat. We walked on that water. We came to Tulsa. We got here. Neither one of us had a job. And my thing was, because we were, Lisa's a major, has a master's in accounting, and I grew up dealing with rental property. I don't rent. That is taboo to me. I don't rent. We came here, didn't have a job. I'm like, baby, we not renting. People tell us you can't buy a home if you don't have a job. Those angels came and encompassed us by a man who had his own financial institution. And guess what, make the long story short, we bought a house. I got a job soon working for a come and go, but at that moment, we didn't have a job. Neither one's had a job, but we got finance. Don't tell me that's not God. I'm trying to say, trying to show you, get over your head. I'm trying to tell you, have faith in God, just get over your head. Get in that water. You won't drown, but you got to make a step. Oh, it goes a little further than that. So we got that house, and that house, closing on that house was contingent with closing on our home in Detroit. Our home in Detroit all of a sudden fell through with them, and the buyers couldn't buy. Well, God got us into this house. The people that was on the house gave us early occupancy, so we came down here, we're in the house. And while we're in the house, we find out this house is infested with termites. I mean, you can go up to the seal around the windows and put your finger all the way through it. So that's why the house in Detroit closed. That's how God didn't really want us to have that house. He just used it as a stepping stone. So the people in the house said, well, hey, we're going to give you got 2 weeks, you got to get out. We got down to that last week, and Denise had been running around with the real estate lady. I'm cutting it kind of short. Running around with the real estate lady. She found a house that she really wanted. But it was way over our budget. And I'm like, we can't afford that house. That's way over our budget. I mean, thousands, tens of thousands, way over what we could afford coming down here with no job and had a little money in the bank, but no job. Understanding? No job. So, well, at that time, I did get with come and go making $7 an hour. I'm going from making almost $20-something dollars an hour down to $7 an hour. No benefits type thing. But God was providing. So we got to get out of this house that we're in that's invested with termites. And down about 2 weeks, so we out with the real estate lady. So I said, well, we go look at this house to a window shopping, because we feeling bad about this time. We not finding nothing we can get into. So I said, just do some window shopping, kind of pick us up. Let's go look at this house that my wife was talking about. And, you know, we kind of picked up. So we went over there, we looked at the house that she was talking about. We went all through it, and I'm like, wow, this is awesome. I mean, all this room, I mean, this house. It was three times the house that we're in. Matter of fact, the house that we're in, my son called it a house,
A large hotel room.
It's a house. We call it a large hotel. It was only about probably 800 square feet at the most, if that. So we looked at the house, and I'm like, man, this is my first time seeing a home, too. I'm saying, this is awesome, though, but it was like thousands. I mean, tens of thousands, way over what we could afford at that time. So we're coming out of the house. Denise had got in the car. I was about to get in the car, and the real estate lady was just about to get in the car, and all of a sudden I seen this guy running out of the house and running at us. Well, being from Detroit, you seeing somebody running at you, you get a little concerned. You're like, okay. Your defenses kind of go up, you know. But he came down, and he like, wait a minute. And Denise rolled down the window. He said, did I tell y'all? And he said, well, tell us what? He said, I lowered the price of the house. And he lowered the price of the house right down in our budget. Right down in our budget. And as a matter of fact, the exact numbers that Denise had figured out that was what we could do. And I'm like, okay. And no sooner than he told us that, we went home and we started a procedure. That very next day, a buyer for our house in Detroit came through. And it's like stepping stones. Don't you know how you stack up the dominoes? Everything just fell into place. And we're in this house that's almost 3,000 square feet. Buying a house on a job that making $7 an hour. I don't know what brag about taking the price, but it was about $200,000 home, a little more. On that math don't work out, do it. It's not supposed to work out because it's God. We're in that water that's over our head. We're not worried about it. We're in that water that's over our head. Everything fell into place. This is faith, y'all. I'm trying to show you. We moved in to show you how faith works. We moved in on Thanksgiving Day, our Thanksgiving Eve. Time to be thankful. God showing himself. He's showing out. He's showing that it is him. To show him that it is him even more. My wife, we used to go at the other church in Detroit where we used to do ministry work in the Bahamas. I'm not calling upon my going to the islands and talking about dancing and having a good time. We went to the out islands where they didn't have bathrooms, where you took showers in the ocean. So she's at this particular place. We got separated, and she went to another island. This island had a big mansion on it, and the mansion had this big Gothic-type white statues. And it was demonic. If she could get a testimony one day, she's going to listen to how first time she actually had to deal with demonic demons. So, coming back now, we're in the house, moving in Thanksgiving Day. We're up Thanksgiving morning. I'm up in the house, moving things around, trying to get situated. She goes out in the yard, goes in the backyard. All of a sudden, she's running back in, very serious. Michael, we got to get rid of the statues. I can't stand the statues. I said, what statue? He said, the statues in the yard. We got to get rid of it. I said, no, we're going to leave those statues right where they are. So I go back to doing what I'm doing in the yard. She goes back out there, and she comes back again. She said, no, Michael, we're moving those white statues out of the yard because you know how I have against what those white statues from dealing from the Bahamas. So I said, no, it just rolls up in me. We're going to leave those statues right where they are. So I'm like, why am I saying this? So I said, well, come on, baby, let's go out there and look at the statue. So I grabbed her by the hand, past the heel of the statue. We walk up to the statue. And like the minute we stood in front of the statue like this, our eyes opened up. God working again. You know what the statue was? Everybody knows the story of Abraham. It was a ram wrapped up in the bushes. It was a ram wrapped up in the bushes. At that moment, we dedicated that had everybody, like I say, from African ministers to people off the streets staying there, and they called it the House of Hotel. Get into water over your head. All right. You told this story.
All right. Praise God.
You know, as the Donsons were sharing about getting into water over your head, you know, we started our business. It'll be 11 years in February. He left his job. I was working. We didn't have kids yet, but we started that business with not, first of all, we started a cleaning business, and none of us had janitorial experience, nothing. Like, I don't know what we were doing. But we didn't have all the answers when we started, and we just kind of stepped out when he felt God told, you know, God said move, and we moved. And when I tell you that the blessings that have come from that are beyond what we could have ever even thought to even think about imagining. It's beyond what we could have even, I mean, our wildest dreams, would you say? I mean, it's amazing. I left my full-time job in 2009. And, you know, sometimes I go back just to kind of keep the network and say hi to my friends at OSU. And I'll, hey, y'all. And they're just like, so, really? So you haven't had another job since then? No, I haven't, you know? And we've been beyond busy. We've hired over, you know, in the last 11 years, way over 100 employees we've had, you know, at one time or another, at the most 20-something employees at one time. But, you know, every time it came time to take another step, even when Sister Hill found our house for us, we were in a large hotel room too. But my parents made fun of our first apartment. It was probably like, what was it, 300 square feet? Well, that's not even a large hotel room. It's a small hotel. But when it's time to move, and it's like, okay, it's time to move, and the answers are not there, but you move, and as soon as you step up, there's a provision, you know, and the provision is bigger than what you thought it would be, and the answer is bigger than what you could have expected, and the outcome is, you know, way bigger than you could have thought. So my encouragement, just like he said, step out into the water that's deeper, but also don't give up when you're swimming. Because I've said this before, when you get halfway through the lake, it's going to take just as much energy to turn around and quit as it's going to take to just keep going and get over it. So don't give up in the middle of it. The water might get choppy, might get a little deeper, but just keep swimming, you know, and don't give up, and you'll get to that expected end if you don't give up.
I'll just say this real quick. I don't know why God is putting this on my heart. I normally don't talk about it, but I say about 9 years ago, God put it on my hand. Let me just say this. Every time we sow a seed, God has always came through. You know, a lot of times you got to step outside the box. Step outside the comfort zone. Step out when it hurts, you know. I say about 8, 9 years ago, I want to say nine, I think. We had this particular investment, a large amount, you know, because I stepped out on faith. And the opportunity presented itself, but I sowed the seed. And when I sowed that seed, it came through. And every time I sow a seed, God always put something big in front of us. Every time. Yeah. Say what?
It was something that was one, just like, brother, is this real? This is a real opportunity? This. And, you know, the person that basically gave it to us, they had that opportunity. They sold it to us, but they had gotten frustrated with this investment and gave up on it and sold it to us for cheap. We took it and boom. So, like I said, you know, it doesn't come how you think it's going to come. You can't imagine. And he said it's beyond what you could ask or think, what you could even imagine. And so you're not going to see it. Like Pastor Hill, you're not going to see it. We walk by faith, not by sight. You're not going to see it. It won't necessarily make sense. But if you are confident in God's word and you know his voice, then he will lead you right in the middle of it.
And I tell you, I'm very appreciative of that. You know, God has always opened up doors, and she just told me to sit down. But, you know, I'm thankful. I praise God all the time, you know, because I come from the bottom, literally. You know, I come from nothing. And to see, look back 20 years ago, man, you know, to look at things now, boy, I'm smiling all the time, you know, because I know how hard it was getting here.
And every moment I get, I always try to, you know, thank my pastors for just instilling this thing into me. So, and I thank God for my wife too, because, you know, I'm the visionary, but she put things together.
All right. Okay. Here's my friend, all the way back from what? Albuquerque.
I wasn't expecting to have to get up here and talk, so excuse me. I thought I was just going to come down and, you know, just kind of be one of the folks that says thank you. But I left here a couple of years ago, going to Albuquerque for another job in the same field, but for a pay raise as well, too. And I'm coming back to Tulsa now. This is my first week back, and I'm coming back to another job for an additional pay raise. So. And I think that, you know, in the time that I've been here, I've always felt that that giving was important. And I just wanted, Pastor, Mrs. Hill, I just wanted you to know that whatever you need, and if I can help, I'll do my part. So whatever that requires, whether it's time, whether it's money, whether it's effort, whether it's supporting others, whatever is needed, I'm here for that. So that is my pledge.
All right, okay. Sister Hill, you want to say something? Okay. All right, well, are we about ready to burden it? Because I know how it is when everybody says, well, we'll give $20 a month. I know how that works out. And it's kind of difficult kind of to separate the pledges from whatever the normal offerings are. And sometimes the problem arises. Father, today we thank you. We turn this over to you. Lord, it's not, you said, be careful for nothing, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Father, we're offering the prayer, the supplication with thanksgiving. Lord, we thank you that the needs of men, my God, supplies all of our needs, according to his riches and glory through Christ Jesus. The blessings of the Lord maketh us rich, addeth no sorrow. Father, we thank you because you take pleasure in the prosperity of your servants. And we thank you, Lord, that you are more than enough. You became poor that we, through your poverty, might be made rich. Father, we confess that we have a full supply. Hallelujah. Full supply. And you're able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can think or ask. Jesus' name, we thank you, Lord, because we believe today that the need is met, and we can go on rejoicing and praising God and thanking God for the victory, even right now. Jesus' name. Everybody just say in Jesus' name. Everybody repeat with me, the blessings of the Lord maketh me rich. And no sorrow. My God, say, my God shall supply all my need according to his riches in glory through Christ Jesus. Father, we thank you that the need is met. And we give you praise and glory right now in Jesus' name. Everybody say amen. Amen. Kind of unusual service, but I believe that yet God knew what he was doing. How many can say amen? God knew what we needed today. Let everybody stand. Father, today we thank you. Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for completeness and wholeness. Ha 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 ha. Glory, if you're around somebody, I just want you to just turn around and just come into agreement with them. So, Lord, I thank you that we are complete in you. I'm complete in you. Financially, spiritually, physically, we are complete. We are complete. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. That you are for us and you are with us and you are in us. And Lord, we thank you that all of our needs are met. We give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Satan's power over my life is completely broken. He is a defeated foe. Oh, we thank you, Lord, that we can do all things. Oh, let's finish. We can do all things through Christ. Christ that strengthens us. Greater is he. Is he that is in us. Lord, we thank you today. Jesus' name, we give you praise and glory. Singing this under our feet, and no weapon formed against us will prosper. Father, we give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. This is the victory that overcomes. This is the victory. My faith is the victory today. My faith is the victory. My faith is the victory that overcomes. Father, we give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord, that you who have begun the good work in us, you shall continue to perform it. We give you praise and glory now in Jesus' name. Everybody just say in Jesus' name. Jesus' name, amen. May the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost rest and abide with us now henceforth and forever. Everybody said, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.